My name is Jim Salzman. I'm a professor at Duke University with joint chairs at the School of Law and the School of the Environment. So, as we've talked about, the term markets for ecosystem services covers a very broad range of areas. So you have watershed markets where people are paying to ensure water quality or prevent erosion. You have markets for carbon sequestration. Biodiversity is in some respects the most difficult of the markets because there are the beneficiaries, the people who benefit from biodiversity, are very diffuse, right? We all benefit, but we're not all going to pay. And so it's very hard to set up an actual market for biodiversity in terms of private buyers, private sellers. And so what you see in many cases is government funds. And the markets part is basically trying to find ways to spend the money more efficiently to get, in a sense, more biodiversity bang for the buck. So in that respect, there's a lot of potential. But that's really a case of taking funds that have already been dedicated to conservation and using them more effectively. Except for, you know, beyond ecotourism, in that particular kind of travel segment, it's hard to see markets for ecosystem services creating new funds, or serious new funds for biodiversity conservation. There really, I think, are three main points. The first is one needs to be very clear as a regulator what it is you're trying to achieve. So as we've talked about, a number of these payment schemes, yes, they're being paid to ensure provision of services, but oftentimes there's another goal of poverty alleviation or local development. And so you get some situations where the payments actually don't achieve any of those well. And so there's sometimes confusion, or what exactly is it that you're trying to achieve? So clarity of purpose is the first point. The second point is you must have discrete suppliers and discrete beneficiaries. You have to be able to identify who is going to provide the services, who's going to sell them, and you have to identify who's going to buy them. If either of those is diffuse, there's no market that's possible. And so government can play a very large role in creating institutions to represent the class of buyers or the class of sellers. And then the third thing that's very important is you have to have what's called a currency or a metric. You have to be able to measure what exactly it is that's being provided and what's being bought. Sometimes that's land use activities. Sometimes it's a measure of number of breeding species, those types of things. Wow. So again, let me give you three. So the first research question is, which markets hold the greatest potential for growth? And as I said, there are quite a few different ecosystem service markets. There are markets for water purification, there's market for carbon, there's markets for biodiversity, pollination could be one, flood control could be one. So when people talk about markets for services, it's a very broad area. So the first is, which are the markets that really hold potential for growth? The second is, within those markets, what are the real obstacles to growth, and are these obstacles that can be overcome? Some of the obstacles, like we were talking about biodiversity is a classic public good. We all benefit from all these different features, and it's hard to see how that's going to be overcome. So there's some markets where you can do research and you find we're really not going to, at least there may be ways that we haven't thought of, but the answers are not obvious. And then I think the third area where there's real potential is to try to develop the policies and the laws that are going to create the institutions to facilitate these types of transactions. Do we need to create new types of property rights? You see that with carbon markets, and let's see if an actual tradable allowance for carbon. That's a new kind of property right that was created to allow those markets to develop. Do we need to create institutions? Do we need to create some type of insurance backdrop for these types of transactions? This is still a very young field, right? 10, 15 years ago, if you had said ecosystem services, you would have been met with a blank stare. Today, it's all the rage. And along with that, I think are some unjustified expectations. And so part of what workshops like this do are to separate what are realistic expectations and what's hype, and to try to get us back onto a more productive footing, you might say. One of them is that the area of ecosystem services, it's by its very nature interdisciplinary. Markets, you're talking about economists. Ecosystem, you're talking about ecologists, biologists. Anytime you're talking about sort of market transactions, you need lawyers. We've had some geographers here as well. This particular type of transaction, type of area of activity brings a lot of different disciplines together. And so as a law professor, there are certain aspects I'm just not going to get. And so it's very important to be able to work with folks across disciplines. The other benefit is working across the ocean. The concerns in Europe about ecosystem markets are quite different than those in the United States. Different culture, different assumptions, different physical geography. Europe's been settled for much longer than the States, much longer than Australia, and so there are different opportunities for ecosystem service markets. And so really I think it's operating at two levels. One's the value of interdisciplinary collaboration, and the other is the benefit you get from working across cultures and countries.